I guess I'd like to start with, I'm going to put Chris Nelson on the spot here. Just what's a day in the life look like for you?
Day in the life is I roll out of bed around 8 o'clock, have coffee with my wife until about 9, and then I check my email for all the different places that I work. So CenturyLink is where I've worked for 19 years. I pretty much work from home now, do a lot of contract management with CenturyLink IT operations, and so I'll check my emails there, see what's going on, then I'll check my DU email to see what's going on with the classes that I teach here at College of Ed, and then I teach classes over at Daniels College of Business as well. So, and also, I'm on staff at UCD, teach adjunct there in the math department for quantitative methods and statistics over there. Then I'll just continue on with my day doing many, many spreadsheets. I probably look at 50 spreadsheets a day for all the different things that I'm doing. Then preparing for classes, and then I usually teach in the evenings. So I'm usually on the road around 4 o'clock and teaching around 5 or 6:30 until about 10. So it's usually what it goes like, especially during the fall. It'll be teaching every night from 6 until 10 o'clock at night, Monday through to Thursday. And then some family time, going off to the golf course with my daughter, tennis court with my son, and that's really pretty much a week right there.
So there is life beyond the program. Balanced life, by the sound of it, at least.
Right, right.
Yeah. Melissa, what about you? Typical day, I know there probably isn't such a thing, but what, just give us a rough idea.
I think Chris has had quite a bit of time to adjust. I'm just 2 years out, so I am an assistant faculty at Regis University. I also still work in the clinic as a physical therapist at the University of Colorado Health. I am there probably at university once a week, and then a couple weekend days a month. My schedule at Regis is very flexible, which is nice. I only really have to be on campus when I'm teaching and for meetings. Just so you know, there's a lot of meetings and a lot of emails that you have to attend to. So outside of that, I mean, you're prepping for classes, always prepping for classes. It seems to me that my semesters are all very busy. Some faculty say that they have a lighter semester here or there. I don't feel like I ever have a light semester. So I also, in addition to teaching at the graduate level, I'm also teaching at the undergrad level in our health and exercise science program. So. And then outside of all of that, there needs to be time for research and scholarship as well. So when I'm not doing teaching related and committee related things, I'm trying to do research.
You have a tenure track position, right?
I do.
And you have a 6-year window for promotion?
It's 5 years. 3 to 5 years, but I'm not in a huge hurry.
Okay. Jeff, what about you?
So just being in industry, so I have a research company, Cherry Creek, and 10 employees, and so it's a combination of typical managing the list of whatever the latest projects are. And these are, so going on right now, we have a study for Google, a couple for Facebook, one for Lenovo, two for Walmart. So a lot of big Fortune 500 companies that we have labs, new space that Nick, you'll see next time you're out, with one-way mirrors and people come in. A lot of stuff we do digitally. Most mornings I spend writing, doing kind of original research as well. But it's fun getting to, you know, apply a lot of the RMS stuff to the applied arena, and some are short-term articles, others are longer terms in the books, or developing new instruments. So we're coming up with a new instrument right now to validate tech savviness. So we asked people to rate on a series of scales their self-perception of how tech savvy they are. And then we did a little Roche analysis on that to find out which items work, but then as part of the validation, we brought 50 people in who had answered that and gave them a couple computers, monitor and some cables, and said, hook this up and make it mirror the screen. We timed them and scored them to see how well the instrument actually predicted it. So, but they got $50 to do that.
And I should probably, or maybe Jeff could send a little note to me about inviting students to sign up to be potentially participants in his, I nearly said victims, but participants in these research projects. I do it for fun, actually. I happen to get paid $50, $100 for an hour and a half. But it's really interesting seeing it from the other side. And it's fun to go and see Jeff and his staff. He isn't an English person working for him.
We do.
So this is a really high class operation.
It is. We bring him in to translate.
Let's jump over to Linmar. Tell us a little bit about what's a typical day look like for you?
I joined the IR office last year, so normally I go to office first to check my email and look at my schedule for the whole day and or maybe the coming couple days. Then I start to analyze the data. My job is responsible for analyze the different research data in the school, such as for example, the school they have a career center. They collect the data to analyze what's the situation after students graduate, what type of job they got, and also I also analyze the data like so what's the factor related to students that passed some math courses, something like that. So I think most of the time I just sit there to analyze different data. And after work, I also take the two lights. I take the class at the UCO, University College, Information and Communication Technology, concentrate on the database. So I think it's good for me to expand my skill for deal with the data to use a different program. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Last but not least, Katie. Tell us a little bit about a typical day, not now because you've been a mom, but when you get back to work full time maybe, what's it look like?
Yeah, so I'm home 3 days a week right now with the new baby, but generally when I'm here, I work in the institutional research with Lynn, and my job is to manage course evaluations for the university. I work a lot with faculty data, and then we'll also do ad hoc things as come up. Like for instance, this week I'm working on the physics department wants to know about how many of their students graduate and versus how many applied, so looking at their admissions funnel, and then looking at how many actually complete the program. So different things like that. I'm also working on with marketing and communications to help push some more faculty data out to our website. So working on pieces like that, going to lots of meetings to figure out how to connect data across the university.
Okay. Thank you. You've all been out a while. I guess who would be the most recent? Melissa, probably, followed by Katie. Then I'm thinking Jeff, Linmar. Okay, you two together.
Yeah.
Okay, Linmar and then Chris. I guess the big overarching question, maybe we can start with Jeff on this one. To what extent, just talk about the extent to which you use the skills that you got in that program. And the reason why I say you've been out a while is I'm guessing you've probably moved on a little bit since then too. But can you just talk generally about the skills that you got from the program and the extent to which you incorporated them and maybe still do in your work?
Yes, I think as I mentioned earlier, I think a lot of the work that I've done with Kathy is part of both my dissertation and the coursework of item response theory. It's just still pretty cutting edge in a lot of fields. So to learn that and apply that to an area where we're constantly measuring human behavior and making decisions upon that, immediately applied it, and it's still continues to be very helpful. And obviously, also just kind of constantly having to review literature and summarize literature, it's just always a good skill to be able to crank out and do quickly, trying to understand research and everything.
Okay. That's good. What about you, Melissa? What about you in relation to what you learned in the program?
I think that we're constantly thinking about, maybe I'm speaking for myself, but probably everybody on this panel is thinking the same, but I think you're constantly thinking about the skills that you have in your toolbox and how you can use them. And these things just don't come naturally per se. You still have to go into the books and you still have to do the research and educate yourself further on how to use those. I know with a number of the projects that I'm doing, I'm also continuing to use the Roche model and item response theory, and as well as some more complex modeling techniques, since I tend to gravitate towards larger databases in the healthcare system. So I think it's just thinking of ways to make your research better. Like, what skills do you have in your toolbox that you can use? And we learned so much. And I can't speak for everybody, but my time here at DU was very rapid. So, I mean, I graduated in just over 3 years. And so I learned a lot in a little bit of time. And so now I'm in a place where I can kind of sit back and kind of start to really think about what I actually have to use.
Terrific. Now, Linmar, you've taken, this is your second or third job since you left DU, so maybe you can answer this question in relation to the work you did at Boulder and now.
I agree with Melissa. I think that in this program, we learn a lot of knowledge about statistic methods and also psychometric methods. I think when you go to work, maybe you cannot use so much, but I think it's good that you learn a lot and help to you when you're in the work, then you know in the different situation what kinds of methods you can pick from your big box.
Mm-hmm.
I think from this program, of course, very important you know all of the fundamental, for me, is quantitative analysis, the methods, methodologies at the scales. And also, I think it's good for you to think when you got a big raw data sets, how do you deal with the data sets? How do you clean? And what's the logic between of the item? And how do you reconstruct the data sets for your analysis? And also like a recoding, something like that. I think, and also I think in this program, another important is educate you, how do you think when you have a question? So how do you think to, from what aspect, how do you analyze? I think this is the way of the, like a research or analyze scale, also very important.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
Super. Thank you very much indeed. Chris, can you answer that question?
Yeah, I use the skills every day. It's unusual that I've been at a telecommunications company for 19 years. That's very strange. I've been in the same position for 19 years. I haven't changed. The company's changed 3 times, though, on me. So I've gone through US West, and then a merger with Quest, and then a merger with CenturyLink, and now a merger with Level 3. So this is actually the we didn't change the name this time, but we merged again. And so using my quantitative skills to help solve problems for senior management is what I do every day, and it's really kept me around. I mean, I've gone through so many different groups of maybe 30 people in my group, and then layoffs come, and now we're down to 3. And then we go back to 30, and then we're down to 2. But I've been around the whole time, and so I think the quantitative skills have really helped to keep me around. And so I initially started the program to start a consulting business with my wife, and we did that right after I graduated. We were going really hard into the business. We had lots of work going on, and it was really busy. And we were up until 3 a.m. every night writing reports and doing things. And we had 2 little kids. Mm-hmm. We said, okay, time out. This isn't working very well. It's working really. The money is nice, but this isn't working for a life. So we decided to scale back on the consulting business. And now I just do dissertation consulting. I've helped 100 students get through their dissertation since I graduated. I've been doing that over and over with dissertation consulting. That's something I can do on my own time. It's family friendly. And then teaching. Decided that teaching was a lot more family friendly and a lot less stress than consulting work. So we'll probably get back into it. My son is now becoming a math major, and he'll take over the consulting company. He'll be young and ready to go, and so then we'll help him do that once he gets up and running with that. So, yeah.
Interesting.
So, yeah.
And Katie, what about you?
I think similar to what Lynn said, lots of work with data and figuring out how do you look at data from the whole perspective. But I think something a little bit different that has been fun for me to work on is I get to work with a lot of units on campus to really say, like, well, what data are you trying to collect? And is that question and the way that you're asking it getting at what you really want to know? So that's been really fun for me to be able to say, like, how can we make this data, whatever you're collecting, whether it's course evaluations or information about your students or about your program or things like that, how do you ask the right questions and get that data that you need.
So now there's a question for you to tell us what you think RMS should be doing. So you can target your comments to us as faculty, but also to the students. The question really is, what skills does RMS, the program and the students, need to be thinking about that maybe they're not getting or may not be getting in their coursework? Is there anything new out there? We as faculty are talking about this a little bit, starting to think about it a little bit. But if you could give some thought to that, and let's start with Chris this time. You already started once, though, haven't you?
That's okay. I'll start again.
Okay.
I've got
let's start with Melissa. Okay. Let's just keep it equitable. Melissa, why don't we start with you this time?
I think one of the biggest things, I did have an opportunity years ago to work at Craig Hospital in their research department, and I think one of the biggest things, and I don't know how much the program has changed in the last couple of years, but one of the biggest things that you must do in most institutions is track your code. So even if you're using SPSS, which is a point and click, you still, I think that it needs to be reinforced in all of the classes that you paste your code and that you keep track of it and that you date it and you keep it in a file. Because I know when I first went out, I was, you know, when I was using SPSS, I was saving all my output files, but I didn't necessarily have a syntax file. And it's really, really necessary to have a syntax file, because if something happens to you, then somebody else can come in and look at your code and do what they need to do with the data. So I think if there's one thing, that's one thing that I would recommend that you put into practice in all of your classes.
Okay. Lin-Mar, what about you? What do you think the RMS program and maybe the students should be thinking about in terms of that toolbox? Anything new?
I definitely agree with her. I think you have a, when you analyze the data, the data could be a huge, and also you analyze, you have a different version. So you normally keep the different version, but after 1 month later, when you look at back, you may be confused what you did and forgot the detail. So I think first, I think maybe the class never teach you, but I think it's very important. So when you start analyze, you have some idea how do you organize your file, mm-hmm. and what's the main step, and also how do you name your file, very important, keep them in order. Because for example, when I analyze data, it could be more than 10 data sets, is that right?
Yes.
So my experience after many times, I find I always put a number in front of the file. So when you open the file, they automatically sort by order. Then you say, oh, step one, step two, step three. Then add put the keywords in your file name and maybe some data sets help to you quickly catch each step. And also keep the syntax also very important, and also have a log. So for each data analysis, you have a log of your analysis. So you keep the main step, and also for the detail, all the detail keep in your syntax. So then they automatically put it there. So then you can, anything wrong, then you can go back to, from the back, then you start to reproduce your data. I think that's where have a good behavior to organize your data, organize your file, very important.
I also, to add to what Lynn's saying, is I also add notes to my syntax files. Because you can add notes, and it's not going to interrupt your analyses if you wanted to run it. You can hide it in such a way where you can just have notes, and I'll write myself notes so that I remember. The other thing to also add is you never want to lose your original data file. So, you know, you're working with the data and then you save, you know, you're working with the data, you make changes and then you save it and that's it, it's gone, right? If you always want to do save as and rename it as something else.
That's great. Let's go to Katie now. You've had two jobs. You were at Cherry Creek School District and now you're at DU. Anything new that we should be thinking about?
I think something that's been really valuable for me is just learning how to kind of translate RMS language and data and analysis for more like the layperson. person. I did a lot of work in Cherry Creek Schools with principals. They look at their school's test data, and there's lots of accountability requirements and things with the state. And oftentimes, they haven't had those classes. They haven't had this experience, but they have to comment on this type of data and make decisions about their school. And so just learning how to really translate what this data is telling them and how they can use it to make changes, I think it's been really valuable. I don't know exactly how to apply that to the program, but somehow being able to communicate the data in a way that's meaningful to people who are outside the program as well.
Yeah, good point. And Jeff, what are your thoughts?
Yeah, I think definitely a lot of things that were covered are important. The curriculum and the RMS was very beneficial. I think the things that stand out, probably just practically speaking, is just more R.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we have a license at SPSS in my company. It's just a lot of money. I have only a couple. And so people, of course, like SPSS. It's a little easier. But at the end of the day, it still has limitations. And there's more things you can do in R. And if you're just more comfortable with it, certainly when I'm both hiring people and working with people, the more experience I had, the more comfort. Mm-hmm. And then just in terms of maybe just some more exposure to some more advanced methods, like we use some latent class analysis a lot, which I know we didn't cover much in RMS, and then even like neural networks and other ways of identifying patterns of data. I mean, nice to have, but I think practically speaking.
Is latent class anything like latent growth curve? Or are you just talking?
It would be an SEM.
SEM,
yeah.
Okay.
Model fitting type thing.
Cool.
That we do in R.
Mm-hmm. We've talked about R, and some of the students in here have talked about R.
Yeah.
Chris, thoughts?
Well, he took mine. R is where it's all going right now. From every conference I go to, it's R this and R that. And it's even grabbing a big foothold in corporate America, too. So we've adopted R in our company, and now I'm trying to learn it. And so I was a computer science undergrad, so programming is not new to me, but R is fairly challenging. When it comes to but it's powerful. So it's powerful, but I think I've just really been invested in learning it the last 6 months. I can maybe do some descriptive statistics now in R. It's just taking me a little bit longer than I thought it would take me to get there, but I'm going to get on board with it here.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where everything is going, it seems like. It's free, and it's powerful, and it's complicated. So
I ask a couple more questions, and then we'll open it up, okay? I'm going to switch a little bit to how you find a job. This is one of the questions that several students pitched to me and said, ask them how they went about getting a job. How did you interview? Maybe you can see this from both sides. Jeff, you're an employer now, and maybe Chris too, I don't know. But just talk about the job process, how you identified positions, how you interview, and maybe the most pragmatic might be, how do you negotiate salary? And the extent to which you do negotiate salary. So let's start with Lin Ma this time.
I think it's good for me. I'm looking for a job here. When I joined this program, I want to be like a faculty or research. So that's when I start to when in the program. What kinds of job I'm looking for? So like I go to the ARA, like a professional program. They always have some job post, and also they also have some workshop for the graduate students to tell you how do you looking for job, how to attend the different professional group, and what kinds of website you are going to. I think that is very helpful. After that, then I look at the public website, the career website. If you search online, there will maybe like a top 5, top 10 website. Then you go to that website, then you can search the different type of job. Then they have an alert. That's alert you link to your email. That's every day or every week you could get the information if they have a new job post on website. Of course, the most important, like a professional associate group, they always have like AERA, NCME, or AEA. They have a associate, they have a job website. I think this is the most related to our program. And even the IR, they have American Institutional Research Organization. They also have a website. You look at the job post, they, from their information, you want to know what the skill they want, then what do you have, what you don't have, how do you improve yourself, or what else the knowledge you need to learn. I think this is a very good. If you find some job you are really interested, then you send out your email, then start to interview.
Thank you. Let's move on. One point to reinforce there. Two things. One is make sure you join a professional association. If you haven't joined one, you should. And Lynn Ma is suggesting AERA, maybe the AIR if you're institutional research. And number two, start looking at jobs now, even if you're only two or three years away, to see, like you just said, what skill sets needed and where maybe what you have and what you don't have, so that you can then push us as faculty to give you what you need. We'll be talking more about that in the spring annual review process. But let's move on to Melissa now. In addition to the job thing, because I'm guessing some of that may be similar for you, is the interview process as the academic and that whole, how did you get the job, how did you negotiate, what stuff?
I think one of the biggest things is, I don't know, I set my sights on what I wanted, and I knew I wanted to teach in Colorado, and there's only two physical therapy schools in Colorado. There's CU and there's Regis. And so I got involved with both of them. I was a lab assistant, and I was teaching in labs at CU, and I was an affiliate faculty at Regis. So either way, I had my foot in the door in both places. So I think that's really important. Get involved. I got involved in research. I worked at Craig. You know, you really want to build your skill set. You want to be marketable to these places. So for me, it was pretty easy because I was at Regis for a year before. I actually got hired full time, so I was affiliate, and being there for a year as an affiliate was one of the most beneficial things that I could have done, because when I went in to interview for the actual job, I already knew the processes, I knew the people, I knew the curriculum. So there was a lot of things that helped me in my actual interview. And I will tell you, the interview process is grueling. It was probably the hardest 2 days, and I was there for about 8 hours both days, and I had to do presentations. I had to sit through panel interviews of about 10 professors at a time, and they were grueling you for an hour at a time. So you really have to prep, and you have to know your facility, and you have to know the institution backwards and forwards. So it's a lot of work. I started the process of getting involved and doing, you know, with the help of Kathy, I started independent research probably in my second year in the PhD program, and I really had to network out, because this is an education, this is a research and stats program that is housed in an educational institution, right? So for me, I'm a physical therapist, so resources were not readily available for me. You have to get out and you have to do the work and you have to network. You have to network for yourself and advocate for yourself, because these guys, they're not gonna be there forever, and you have to learn how to do it on your own. That's one of the biggest things. And you're gonna be more powerful, and you're gonna feel so much better for doing it that way. You're gonna get more out of the process in the long run.
So I'm hearing it goes way beyond, not way beyond, but certainly beyond coursework. And doing papers, you've got to do a bit more to be competitive in an academic position. Talk a little bit about the extent to which you were able to negotiate salary, or was it? Mm-hmm. Yeah, was it?
So I had met with Kathy beforehand, and she kept telling me, you're going to take such a big pay cut. You're just, as a physical therapist, I made decent money. But she's like, you're going to, just get ready, you're going to take a hit. And I actually did the research and got the statistics. And she was kind of right, you know, on the average. We're researchers, we're statisticians, so I knew going into my phone call, I had the stats in front of me, and I was ready. I was ready to fight for just even maybe 10,000 more, right? Just get what I could. And for me, fortunately, the number that got thrown at me was about 20,000 above what I thought it was going to be. So then I'm like, oh my God, like I still have to negotiate, right? I still have to do something. So I negotiated software, and software costs money, and so... that was something that, and I had done the research before on what I thought was going to be a was going to be fair, and so I actually thought I was going to be fighting for the salary, but in the end, I was not fighting for the salary. I was just negotiating some software that was going to help me along the way.
Great, super. Thank you, Chris. What's your thoughts on this issue? Slightly different environment for you.
Yeah, many of my jobs, teaching jobs or consulting jobs, have come through American's Statistical Association, Colorado Wyoming chapter. I was the president there for about 4 years at the Colorado Wyoming chapter, and just met a lot of great people who enjoy statistics from all over, different organizations, different companies, different teachers, professors throughout the metro area, and even into Wyoming. I would recommend looking into that. For a student membership, it's like $15 for a year. They're always looking for student presenters. You can easily get a presentation at either the spring or the fall meeting. Plenty of opportunities to even if your research isn't done, just to talk about it. They are more than willing to have anybody speak there, and it's really good feedback that you get from the small group. It's a fairly small group that attends the meetings, probably around 50 people. I don't know if it's grown much since I left, but that's a good place to start with that. So I really enjoyed that experience and getting to know everybody there. Let's see what else. Negotiating, if you're in non-academics and negotiating salaries, never give the number first, all right? So, oh, well, what do you think you'd like to start at? Well, never give that number, all right? Never. So say, shoot it back to them and say, well, what do you think my experience is worth? And have them give you the first number, and then from there, you can then add another $10,000 onto it. They expect you to negotiate with them if it's a corporate job or something like that. And a five-minute call for $10,000, it's worth it, all right? So. And they expect you to do that. So research what the value is out there for the position that you're looking at. There's plenty of online, you know, opportunities to see what people are earning, and put a little confidence interval together of that, and then go for the high side. That's what I would do.
Jeff, similar or different perspective for you actually own a company?
Yeah, I ask people the number first, so.
And they give it to you.
Yeah, most people do.
Wow.
You know, the main advantage of doing that is you don't want to waste anybody's time. Mm-hmm. And sometimes we'll get a lot of people that move from California, and they're used to making a lot of money out there for the cost of living, and they've just sort of adjust that down. But if you go through the whole interview process and you realize, wow, we're, you know, a substantial amount off, it can be a little bit of a waste. But even if somebody doesn't give me a figure, we're fortunately in our industry, we actually run the salary survey for the User Experience Professional Association, so we have all the data on salaries from across the world. And I actually have a calculator on my website and say, look, here are the key drivers in a multiple regression analysis which predicts your salary. And so I can plug them in and tell you with a pretty reasonable prediction interval of where you are. So if somebody gives me a figure, I'll say, okay, let's see, or tell me what you come up with. Well, based upon where we are, this is probably where you are. And there's a little bit of wiggle room in there. But if somebody's way off, but certainly, I would expect people in the quantitative field to have found that it's very easy on their website to find it. And I think in every field, that data is out there, and having that, approaching it quantitatively. And then I'd say just recommendation is, when we get people that apply, we throw out a lot of requirements in terms of skills. And I think a lot of people get the sense that if you don't have every single one of those, that somehow you're not qualified. And a lot of times you're putting those job descriptions together and you're like, well, a lot of these would be nice or be good, but sometimes you don't have them and you could show that it's not necessarily essential, but you can pick them up. Don't so easily give up or don't apply. It's usually the people with just a little bit more perseverance that get the job.
Just quickly, Jeff, thoughts on when you're interviewing people, what are you looking for? Because you have master's and PhD people working
with you. Master's and PhDs work for me. You know, the ability to get a data set and quickly put it together in a PowerPoint presentation under a little bit of pressure and then present it. So that's part of the interview process. They come in. We already give it to them online, so they have time to do it, just like you would do in your coursework. And so it's, can you take the data in a short amount of time? And then earlier what you were saying, communicate it to people who are not going to be comfortable.
Okay. Thank you. Katie, thoughts from you about this process, the job process?
I agree with all those things. I think you can also, in terms of negotiation, you can look at benefits. It's something that I've looked at in the past as a way to negotiate. Whether that's vacation or something else. I had a job the whole time I was going through the program, so I think I was in a little bit of a different position. But for me, it's always been practical pieces, like I want to be in Colorado, certain aspects. jobs that met my needs rather than casting the wider net.
Okay. My last question, and then we'll turn it over to you all, so make sure you have some questions. We haven't heard the word qualitative yet. Have you noticed that? What's up with that? So I just want to ask, and I won't pick on anybody here because I'm getting a bit nervous. I'm thinking, what's my sample like here? Classic qualitative research sample. It's just, I didn't think about it. So what thoughts about qualitative in this thing? Melissa.
So I'm currently working on three projects. We will be implementing qualitative research in all three projects. So one project, I don't know if you guys know anything about the physical therapy world, but there was this big debate on whether or not regarding dry needling. So I don't know if anybody is in the know, but it was a huge issue, and acupuncturists were saying that physical therapists didn't have enough education to be doing dry needling so soon out of school. And they wanted to increase the number of years before you can actually do it. And it went to the House and through legislation, and physical therapists actually won. So we don't have to change anything about our curriculum or the processes for dry needling, but in that process, we actually did put out a survey, and we did get for patients and physical therapists, and we did get qualitative research. So right now, we're in the process of just getting a baseline paper out with just risk ratios, descriptives. Following that, we're actually going to dive into the qualitative research that we had gotten, because that takes a little bit more time. I was in New Orleans last week for our combined sections meeting, which is like a national conference for physical therapy, and we actually presented we created a catalyst group with the hope to go to a special interest group for LGBTQ issues in healthcare. We put out a survey prior to the meeting. We didn't think we were gonna get that many responses. We actually got about 350 responses. So we are going to publish a paper there, and we're also going to follow that paper up with some qualitative interviews. So qualitative, and then finally, the project that I wanted to do for my dissertation, but I didn't actually do because I wanted to actually get out of here quicker. I'm actually getting ready to embark on a very large mixed method study, which will involve a significant amount of qualitative research. It's growing. There's been a lot of debate about the level of evidence of qualitative research, and I think that the more that we go to the House and the more that we lobby, I think the higher level of evidence qualitative research is going to grow into.
Okay. Does anybody else have anything to throw into the qualitative pot? Chris?
Yeah, sure. I don't make this known very often, but yeah, I got my start in qualitative. That's where I started my career in qualitative. I was a captain in the Air Force, and I'm doing consulting. We'd go around to all the different Air Force bases and identify areas of improvement for improving software development processes, and we would do interviews, and then we'd roll them up to common themes, and we'd be able to identify areas of improvement to help people improve their software development process. Mm. I leveraged that to then go work for PricewaterhouseCoopers. Everything was qualitative interviews, rolling up things for common themes, and helping organizations improve their processes. And then now even I use qualitative once in a while if there's a problem with projects being late, and there's some type, we see it quantitatively, all these projects are late, then I'll go in and we'll interview project managers, what's going on, how can we help you guys improve meeting deadlines. So yeah, qualitative is a big part as far as interviews and common themes and being able to identify those.
Jeff, you're nodding.
Yeah, I mean, as you know, about half of what we do is actually qualitative, and our field of UX research is dominated by qual, and so our company is known for more quant in there, but definitely mixed methods. And so actually that's what's one of the hard things for when we hire, is that you need to be both quant and qual. And so obviously being in the RMS program makes people very well qualified, but going deep in one-on-one interviews, observations, understanding how people are solving problems around websites and software. So
okay.
Very important.
Good to hear. And Katie, you're probably the one, at least the one I know, is most grounded in qualitative, just academically at least here.
Yeah, I'm not necessarily doing large-scale statistical modeling. I'm doing a lot more working with people on a smaller-scale basis in terms of answering their questions, and oftentimes they just don't have enough people to do anything too large in terms of sample size, so qual comes up a lot.
Mm-hmm. Nima, thoughts on the qualitative side of things?
As think a qualitative very important. My personally, I have a strong skill in quantitative, mm-hmm. but I do weakness in the qualitative. I think a language always important, no matter what you are doing, because you need to interact with the people. So no matter what kinds of reports you did, data reports you did, you still need to write out the reports. That's a qualitative. Mm-hmm. And how do I think if you have a quantitative skill and you also have a qualitative skill, it will definitely help you a lot and get more chance, and also you can quickly get your results. I think, in my opinion, I think to some degree, qualitative is more important. Language skill is super important, I think. But I'm not really good at this.
Before we turn it over to the students, is there anything else that any of you would like to elaborate on that you've touched on, that you want to add more to?
I think one thing is that I can speak for the health profession, that we are moving towards interprofessional education and collaboration. And so you're not just going to be working in your own bubble, is really what I'm saying. Is there's so much opportunity to collaborate with other people in other disciplines, and it's really afforded me the opportunity to get to use a lot of different types of statistical techniques. I think that's what really helps to keep me abreast in research, whether that be quantitative or qualitative.
Okay, let's turn it over to, I'm gonna start with Jen, because Jen, you sent me a bunch of questions. Why don't you throw one of your questions in there, and then we'll just open them.
Sure, again, my name is Jen Light. I'm a second year PhD. One of my questions was, do you stay in touch with your RMS colleagues, and do you network? How do you do that? Do you see the benefit of that?
I've stayed in touch with a number of the people that I graduated with. I don't profess to know everything, and sometimes it's good to be able to talk with somebody else about the analysis. And actually, Elizabeth Anderson, who graduated a year after me, is actually, her and Courtney Vidakovich are coming onto a project as statisticians. And we're applying for a grant and so forth, so.
Interesting. Sounds like not a lot going on there with that. Katie, are you nodding or not?
I mean, I think I know generally where people are at. I wouldn't say they have done a lot of networking.
I think as a program, and frankly as a college, I know this to be true, we don't do a good job with alumni relations, but also inter-alumni relations. And it's actually, I'm on the strategic planning committee, and we were talking about this just yesterday. So I think the silence you're hearing, Jen, and this is probably no surprise, probably why you asked the question, I'm guessing, in part. You probably knew the answer, did you?
No, well, I was just wondering if you've gotten jobs with each other, or you're sharing the information.
Well, there's a little bit of that with Melissa.
Well, I also think that one of the things, like Jeff and I's cohort, we were all in different areas. Nobody was really, there was no competition. Nobody was really going into the same area. We were all just, we were there, we worked together through the process, and then we got our wings. And then we just kind of went on our way and did the things that we were most passionate and interested in, which didn't really align. Everybody's goals and aspirations really didn't align together, in a sense.
I will say, like, working for education, I worked for Cherry Creek Schools, that there were definitely people from the RMS program that were in other school districts. Maya Martin-Zinn worked for Aurora Public Schools. Dan, blanking on his last name, works for the state. So there's pockets where you can see, depending on what direction you want to go, what area of interest you have, I think you'll find the RMS alumni there and make those connections that way. I think you kind of have to target, okay, what area am I interested in? Kind of like what you were saying, Melissa, it's like, if you're not interested in education, those alumni aren't going to help you.
Yeah, but Jim, maybe we could talk about how we could do harness at that, because we've got a fair amount of graduates out there. Obviously, there's five here today, but there's a lot more Chris as well. So let's open up questions.
I just add one more to the networking thing. I've been out for 12 years now, and for the first few years, we stayed in contact quite a bit. If I was, and another thing is, most of my cohort is outside of Denver,
mm-hmm.
so it's not like we get together much at all, but if I was in their city, we would get together.
Mm-hmm.
That usually lasted for about 5 years, but now we're all on LinkedIn, so we can always get a hold of each other if we needed to. So it does, I mean, I can get a hold of anybody from my cohort if I wanted to.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But yeah, LinkedIn is a good little tool for that, I think.
Terrific, thank you. Mahmoud?
So my question is for Jeff and Chris, since it seems you guys are coming from non-educational backgrounds. So was the program a game changer for you guys, or was it the make it break it thing?
Yeah, I wouldn't be able to do pretty much anything that I'm doing without the program.
Yeah.
I've been able to carve out a really good quantitative practice within my company, been able to do consulting that I would have never been able to do without the QR. I was in the QRM program, quantitative research method, now the RMS program. So yes, it's been invaluable. I wouldn't be able to do the teaching, the consulting, the dissertation consulting. Wouldn't be at the same company, I'm sure. So yeah, it was a game changer for me, for sure. Yeah, I didn't know it at the time, but it really was.
Yeah. And yeah. I mean, I think I was already in the field for a little while before I got it, but I think it was to enhance areas, particularly item response theory and some more advanced methods that are just a lot harder to pick up on your own and get applications for. But that's certainly, you know, puts you in a sort of a much more select class of people that can do things. So it's extraordinarily helpful. Yeah.
I think that rings true, especially for my field, because they're actually in the education field. More complex modeling is like individual growth curve modeling and hierarchical linear modeling. It's being used more profusely in the physical therapy realm. It's starting to get more impetus, but people don't understand the language. I mean, I submitted a proposal to research for this combined sections, and I wanted a platform, and it was individual growth curve modeling, and it was more complex and higher level modeling, and I got a poster, and I said to my supervisor, hey, you know, you told me to submit this to research. I should have submitted to health policy, and he said, you know, they probably just didn't even understand what you wrote. So I think it's also important to, you know, and that's something maybe I need to go to another conference, like a research or statistics oriented conference to present the modeling. But I always have to remember that I kind of have to bring the language down in my field because they're just not there. So what does that do for me? It people want to work with me because they're like, I want to learn more about these modeling techniques, so I'm more marketable to my field.
Anybody else got anything on this issue before we move on? Okay, that's another question. Mitha, welcome.
Hello, I am finally at dissertation stage, and I'm wondering how you've been able to leverage your dissertations in your careers. If the answer is not at all, just say it. I can live with that.
Well, you know, it's funny. They always say to us, you know, you should be able to live off of your dissertation for 5 to 10 years, something like that. Well, I don't remember who said that.
Why did you say that?
But I actually just presented last week.
Okay.
On a paper from my dissertation, and I do plan to publish, and there are maybe two other papers in the works.
Mm-hmm.
But there's so many things that happen when you get done. So
mm-hmm.
it's the
tell me.
It's just time. I mean,
can you
relate?
I was able to get one presentation out of it.
Okay.
I wanted to do something with it.
Yeah.
So one presentation, conference presentation, I got out of it. So I thought that was good. But yeah, it's different after you're finished. You look around and say, well, what do I do next now, right? And I was looking for the next big mountain to climb. So
yeah.
Right after I graduated, I wanted to go out and buy a house. I wanted to go out and do all these other things. And
yeah.
I wanted to get a director or VP job. So I started interviewing all over the place. I just had to have that next thing to do. And fortunately, my wife had gone through the same process. And she said, just relax a little bit. Like,
yeah.
Take 6 months and just do nothing. It's okay. And that was good because then I got all that out of my system and I didn't go look for the VP job anywhere after that. Didn't buy the big new house after that. It was actually a good thing.
Jeff, folks?
Yeah, pretty good luck with my dissertation. I was able to focus, you know, there's probably, you know, 3 or 4 chapters in there. I think 3 papers out of it so far. And more to come, just knowing that I feel like I covered a lot that, at least in my particular field, that hadn't been delved into, and I knew I wanted to, like, start replicating things. And I think that's really it's up to you. You can really take that direction now while you're still creating and saying, you know, am I going to be sick of this? Is this a methodology I'm going to want to use in 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 years? Mm-hmm. Go down that path, and then, you know, even if you can't explore it all in your dissertation, it definitely opens the doors. And you do go back. What I'll often do is I'll say, boy, I had a really good literature review on that topic. I'll open up my dissertation and I'll find all those references for myself, you know, for something, or God, I can't. What were those fit indices thresholds again for the CFI? And then, you know, so I'll go in my dissertation. I'm like, oh yeah, here's some good ones when I'm writing other papers on that, so that can be real.
You know what I actually did? I just went back to my dissertation for this presentation, and I was like, oh my God, I could have done that so much better. I don't know. So I think I'm more critical of myself, and how I wrote up certain sections and what I could have added and what I missed. So,
Katie, you wrote a master's thesis. Qualitative.
Yeah, I was going to say, I guess the thing that I did get a presentation out of my master's thesis, but I think it also was really helpful in figuring out that that necessarily wasn't the area that I wanted to spend my career in. I did a thesis on working with visitor studies in museums, and going to the conference and doing the presentation helped me to realize that there wasn't enough opportunity in that field, and it wasn't exactly where I wanted to be. So I think that was valuable in the sense that I'm not doing a lot with it now, but it really gave me a sense of, okay, don't just move in this direction. If you don't, it gave me the chance to test the waters, I guess.
Hey, Mo, did you do anything with yours, dissertation?
we have one paper published, based on my dissertation. I tried two, but so far only one. I think it's good that you can extend your research after you graduate. But I think sometimes it depends on what the job you got. Mm-hmm. So on one side, you're looking for some job you want. On the other side, the job marketing, maybe you cannot get what you want. So you need to change. So I think it's, if you cannot get what you want, I think it's good that you have a good sense of to how to figure out the question, how to solve the question, and how do you expand your skill, and also how do you can catch up the new skills and keep learning. I think this is a general you can apply to your whole life. But for the exactly the research question, I think it depends on the situation. Yeah.
Okay. Other questions?
I have another one.
Okay.
If you don't mind. So how to put your first foot on the door, especially if you're interested working for non-educational institutes / consulting or working? Is it through applying for an internship? How do you market yourself? Because
I think that's a no-brainer. So that's an easy place to start, is if you can find an internship, even, you know, propose an internship. Don't necessarily just look for one. If there's a company you want to work for, an organization, you go out there and see those opportunities, but most of the best jobs aren't even posted. You know, those opportunities aren't posted. And then you immediately, you know, even after that amount of time, so the way we treat our interns is they get the same amount of experience as our regular employees, they get paid. And then after just a few weeks or a few months, you know, infinitely more, you just knowing the language and the jargon of the field that you want to go into and sort of what's important, what's not important, how to communicate, suddenly become a much more desirable candidate to a lot of the people saying, all right, well, somebody could tolerate this person at their company for a little while. They must be, there's something there. That's an easy place to start. Conferences, papers, experience.
Don't wait for the job to come to you. Start now. If you haven't started yet, start today. Because it's going to be critical when you get out there to make those connections.
And the best way to do that is the professional societies, and there are so many specific and targeted ones for program evaluation or statistics or education or whatever you want to get into. Find it and then go get to the local chapter meetings and start getting involved, and even maybe be a treasurer or something like that. Be part of the overall local chapter as well.
Questions? You're all stunned. Is this a good stunt, or is this a like, oh my God, what have I got myself into stunt?
Yeah, maybe I have a question.
Go on, Niba, yeah.
Yeah, I know you talked about you know, using other techniques like neural network and stuff like that, do you actually get into machine learning kind of techniques in analyzing data, or?
No, you're often, at least in my industry, we're often presented with a problem and there's not like a cookbook of what method you should use, but there's often opportunities to try out different methods. And you know, very concretely, what I mentioned, latent class analysis, what often comes up a lot is that when you're dealing with a lot of the data that sort of merges between marketing and product research, they want to know, well, how do we segment all these millions of people that come to Facebook or come to Walmart or do these things on Google, and we have all this data on them, how do we know which variables differentiate them, which variables sort of predict future behavior, and then how can we then tailor products or market to them? So that's sort of the general business goal, and then you can see, well, I probably could use a factor analysis, I could do some principal, I could do multiple regression, I could do some logistic regression, and then you said, well, what about some of these more advanced techniques like neural networking, like in class analysis? And so that's how it came up, at least for us, is having more of those, as Melissa mentions, tools that you can then try out. A lot of them converge on similar solutions, but sometimes others provide just a slightly more crisp picture of the outcome.
I think it's really catered to what your specific research questions are, and you know, and then discussion with your partners and your collaborators to see exactly what they'd like to do with the data, or how much data they're going to actually have for you to do things with, because that's going to impact the type of analysis that you're going to use as well. So you know, you start the discussions early, and then move forward from there.
And I think it's when you get out of the program, wow, what model could I apply to this problem? I could do a three-level HLM,
yeah.
HGLM, multi-level logistic regression, when a t-test would just be fine, all right? and so just do the, that's what I do. I try to do the easiest thing I can do, especially within corporate America. I'll just put up, here's the average for this group, here's the average for that group, and then a little star that says they're different. I don't even put, there's no p-value is going to be up on that screen at all. That they would laugh me out of the conference room if I did all that. What's all this stuff up here? And so then, yeah, I'll have a little star that says if you need more information, I'll provide it for you. But yeah, I just do the easiest thing possible, and it works just fine. So
as we begin to wrap this up, I'm going to throw one question in. It's an obvious one, but I'll say it. Two questions actually, but I'll ask the first. Things that you know now that you wish you knew either during or immediately after graduation. Another way of thinking about that is, what advice would you give for the folks around the table? So it's kind of two questions, they're kind of similar. Shouldn't really ask two questions in one go, but I'm doing it. So thoughts about what you know now that you didn't know then, and or what advice do you have for these folks? Most of these folks, I think, are PhD students. There's some masters, a couple of masters in here too.
I'm thinking.
I mean, I think like your question earlier about the dissertation. I think that was, you know, you're going to be going down that path for a couple of years. Really think out about how maybe you can make the most of that effort and how you can leverage that. That was good. I mean, I think it would have been more encouraging, more motivating at the time, but even though I still went down the path I think I wanted to go down, knowing that that was helpful.
Just be open to your career path. I went in with a specific view of I want to be a consultant, I want to do all this, and I don't want to teach. That's not even on the radar, and it totally was. I was open to teaching, and I enjoyed it. So just be open to wherever your career may take you. I did consulting, didn't like it as much as I thought I would. So not that I won't do it in the future, but just right now it doesn't seem to fit very well with everything else that's going on. Just be open to trying new experiences, and I learned more teaching intro stat than I did, you know, in a lot of it.
Mm-hmm.
It just,
yeah,
you have to actually teach it to someone,
yeah.
You have to actually know it. So you actually get questions from students and you have to answer them. So I learned a lot from just teaching. And even after 12 years of teaching intro stat, I still learn something new every semester. It's funny, it's weird, but yeah, it's true.
I think just advocate for yourself. Get out there, get the skills and the knowledge that you need to get into the job or the position that you see yourself going into.
Lima, anything?
I think keep trying. I think it's important. Like you go to the conference to do presentation, or you're looking for a job, maybe the first couple of times or maybe several times, it's very worse, it's very bad. I think it doesn't matter because it's good for you to, how to say, based on your personal experience, you get some experience. For example, you learn many skills, how to drive, how to swim, but you never try, you don't know how to improve. So I have like an interview, many a phone interview, to be, because English is my second language, I think it's really worse. Even myself, I say, oh, I want to jump into a hole, I don't want to get any people. But I think it's very good, help you thinking, what should I do? How do I improve? Because if you don't have a such bad experience, you never know. You know only on the, how to say, on the paper. You don't know personally know that. I think try it is very important.
Okay.
I'm just gonna echo what Chris said, that just be open to getting, I mean, your first job may not be exactly what you expected it to be, but there's always options in there to like, oh, I really like this aspect of it, or I really like this aspect, and you can build on those. You can kind of build, at least I've had opportunities to say, this is kind of how I want to shape my career once I'm in a certain position.
So Kathy, you've had most of these students in your classes.
And they all passed.
Eventually. Any things you want to pull out from what you've heard today that would be of value for us to hear?
Well, I think some of the advice that Melissa and Jeff and Chris and Lin-Ma and Katie have given is really good. So if you're thinking about what you want to do 10 years from now, don't wait until you walk at graduation, which you will do, by the way. sooner versus later, you will be finished. And then it's going to be a little late to start developing the networks and the skills. So start sooner. Do research projects when someone says, oh, I have this interesting idea. Then jump on it. So I think the faculty are fairly open to working with students. So, but don't wait for us to come to you either. Sometimes that will happen, but not always. So start making those connections. I mean, the ASA Colorado Wyoming group that Chris mentioned is probably very welcoming. The local Cohen Evaluation Network group is. So get outside of classes. So do stuff outside of classes, and I think be proactive about where you think you want to go with your career. But I'd also like to hear a few words from CJ.
Great.
About what?
When did you graduate, CJ?
14.
Okay.
2014.
Yeah.
You know, everything was great, but don't be afraid, like Lin-Ma said, to fail. I thought I had the best idea for a dissertation. I was sure it was going to work. I knew exactly what I wanted to do. I knew exactly how I was going to ask. And it crashed and burned so badly. But everything I did on that has perpetuated more learning and looking at things differently and more research. And so I am still, 4 years later, reworking my dissertation in my job to try to make what tool, what survey instrument I'm trying to come up with better, so that we're able to screen more students and have effective treatments. And all the skills I learned, I use every day. And it might not be that I pull up SPSS and crank out some numbers. It's just that the t-tests, sometimes you even just know it in your brain that the t-test is going to work, and that helps you perpetuate the research. So.
And Chris, you like the other Chris, you're also teaching in our program and in our university. I mean, thoughts about the whole role of teaching, how's that fit into your identity?
Chris was exactly right. Everything you thought you knew about statistics and how, yeah, you relearn it over and over again until you really, really know it.
Mm-hmm.
It was a fabulous experience to be able to teach. It was really great to be on the other side and to be able to watch people with their interests and to help them out in those different areas and say, yeah, go ahead and give it a try. Yeah, what do you have for data? And let people, hate to say it, fail, because that's how you, at least from my experience, that's how you learn the most on the next steps that you're going to take in your career and your coursework and and just in life. So.
And similar to what Kathy said, as far as research is concerned, if you want to teach, put yourself forward, offer to contribute to a lecture, a part of a lecture. There are teaching opportunities. They're not many of them, but there are. There's a college teaching special interest group that has met twice now. So, you know, teaching and research do go well together, as both Chris's have suggested. Okay, well, hey, this has been great. Can we thank our distinguished panel? Now, I don't know, they probably can't stick around too long because they've got to go back to work, but maybe if you have a question that you don't want to ask, you know, publicly, you can go and nab them before they go. There's also a little bit of pizza left, too. So thank you very much for coming, and we'll see you probably, I think next one's going to be in April, maybe March, I forget. No, there will be one in March. Yeah, I think Robin's doing the one in March, and then Dennis will be doing the one in April. So thanks for coming.
Thank
yeah,
you.
Pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you
very much indeed.